Good afternoon and welcome to probably about an hour of detox. You have been spending all day in interesting sessions, learning things you can actually use, doing things to impress your boss, and for the next hour, we're probably not going to do much of that. As I mentioned earlier, as I proposed this talk, it's basically helping you marvel at the miracle that is the modern Java virtual machine. As we will be working with the Java virtual machine, there will be a lot of code in this. And what I found out that what you didn't know you wanted to know about the Java virtual machine is too long for the name of a GitHub repository. So I tried to abbreviate it to this. And just to make things a bit easier for you, you can also go to cloudthingy.io/defcon18. So there will be a lot of code in here. There will be Java code, there will be C code, there will be some machine code, and of course there will be bytecode. Some of you may already know me. My name is Angelo van der Sijft. I'm a fellow for Luminis Eindhoven. I won't bore you with the technical side. In my spare time, I like to do some Krav Maga, some running, obstacle course racing. So the basic gist is, if something goes bad here, I can run away. Enough about me. Let's talk about the Java platform, because that is what you came for. Java platform consists of a number of parts. And I'll show you an overview now, and we will zoom in on a few of these. We have, of course, the Oracle JVM, which is governed by a specification document. And this Oracle JVM is accompanied by what we call the runtime jar. All the classes you know and love, the things like the linked list and a lot of the concurrency primitives, they're all in this runtime jar. And of course, there's a specification for this too. This allows anyone to build his own Java virtual machine with his own runtime library. And a number of companies have done this. IBM has its own J9 VM, we have JRebel. There are a number of VMs around. For now, we will be focusing mainly on the Oracle JVM. And when you take an Oracle JVM and a runtime library, together you get a Java runtime environment. We have almost everything then. All we now need is a compiler, so we can actually compile our code, and some tools to package up our applications. And you guessed it, these are governed by another document. In this case, the Java language specification. We take these three things on top, and we call this the JDK. For now, we will be focusing on the Oracle JVM and the accompanying virtual machine specification. So let's first take a look at what is a virtual machine. Let's say we have some code, and machine code is written in an instruction set, and that instruction set is understood by some chip. And if this happens to be an Intel chip, this will be the x86 instruction set. This means that this code can only run on this chip. We can put a virtual machine in between. The virtual machine is governed on top. It creates code that is specific for the machine it is running on at that moment, and it is governed on top by a virtual machine specification. You can compare this to the x86 instruction set. It's roughly the same thing. Only the virtual machine specification is a bit broader. We can take code written in this same instruction set and take it to another chip. As long as there is a virtual machine that can create specific code. And we can take it to another machine as long as there is a virtual machine which can create specific code for this specific chip. That's basically what a virtual machine does. We'll be looking into four areas of the Java virtual machine. We'll be going into, this will be the meat of the talk, bytecode, how does the VM work, and what sets the Java VM apart from other components of the Java, from other components in the computing stack. We'll be talking about garbage collection. We'll be talking about the different kinds of optimization that the Java virtual machine does. And we'll have a little detour into the Delphic virtual machine, the machine that runs Java-ish code on your Android smartphone. If you have never looked into processor design or virtual machine design, it can be hard to understand what is and what isn't typical for a virtual machine. I'll point out the things that make the Java virtual machine special. Let's say we have some basically random Java code, which is located somewhere on the file system. These are Java files. We can then compile those, and then we end up with class files. I'm pretty sure we've all seen this. Our toolchain usually automates this for us, but in the end, every build process does this the same way. You may not ever have looked at a class file. So let's try looking at what is in a class file. This is the entirety of the file I just compiled based on the code I just shown you. And if you have never seen a hex dump, left column is line numbers. The middle part is a hexadecimal representation of the contents of the file. And on the right side, we have an ASCII representation of that same data as far as that is possible. We see a lot of dots in here. A lot of things just don't have an ASCII representation. Some things do. For instance, this 70 over here corresponds to the letter P on the right side. What makes this a Java file? All Java files start with a so-called magic number. This is followed by a major and minor version number. This is how you recognize a Java file. And all Java virtual machines, the first thing they do is check, is this a Java file? The second thing they check is, can I actually run this version of the bytecode? So if you ever had the JVM complaining to you that it cannot run version 51 of this, version 51 class file, it knows because of this constant. Now let's get back to our code. I've hidden a magic value in here. This number 42 is a 2A in hex. And we have two locations where this 2A shows up. What we're going to do is we're going to follow where the code leads us to actual instructions. We take a little bit of context, and we try to find out what this piece of code is actually doing. We have a document for this, which is a Java language specification. And in the Java virtual machine specification, it says that every number, every what we call opcode, operation code, corresponds to some operation. In this case, the 05, it says here, corresponds to an iconst 2. This is probably not what we're looking for. Iconst 2 is basically the number 2, but there is no number 2 in my code. Let's take a look at the other one. This one says bi push. And bi push takes something and puts it on the stack. It takes a byte and it puts it on the stack. And it takes the number after the opcode, so it takes our 2A and it pushes it on the stack. This is probably what we're looking for. This is a very tedious way to go through all the bytecode. Fortunately, JVM comes with its own tooling for this. JavaP, the Java printer, allows you to create a nice representation of what is going on in your code. And in our case, it gives us this. It shows that we have a class, we have a method, this simple addition method is a constructor, and we have a main method. And the piece of code we're interested in is this block. This is our main method, which corresponds to the code we looked at earlier. What I'm going to do is I'm going to step through all the lines of the code, explaining what they do. All Java virtual machines have what is known as a bunch of local variables. These are identifiable by a number, and we will need these numbers later. Also, they all have a stack. And what is usually done is that local variables are just placed at the bottom of the stack. So we now have this bi push instruction. As you can see all the way at the top, this consists of two bytes, one that says bi push and one that says 2a. This is our number 42. Bi push takes that number, pushes it onto the top of the stack. Next one, we have istore 1. This says, take whatever is on the top of the stack and store it in location 1. Let's do that. Then we go to iconst 4. Iconst is an integer constant number 4. For a number of often used values, minus 1 up to plus 5, there are constants. This means that if you have the number 4, you can write it in a single byte instead of having to expend 2 bytes. might make your code a little bit more efficient. So what this does is it pushes the number 4 onto the stack. And then we end up with an istore 2. And you can probably guess what this does. It takes the top of the stack and puts it in location 2. Now we have filled up our local variables with a few interesting things. Then we have a load instruction. This says take whatever is in location 1, put it on the top of the stack, and you can probably guess what iload 2 does. So now we have two values, our 4 and our 42, on the top of the stack. Now we end up with the iadd instruction. This is just a single byte. So when we take a look at the specification, it takes two values, the two values on the top of the stack, and replaces them with the result of the calculation, in this case, adding the two numbers. So we end up with the number 46 on the top of the stack. Finally, we have an istore 3, which takes this single byte, stores it in location 3. So that is the equivalent of the Java code we have seen in bytecode. And it may just be me, but this looks reasonably readable to me. You can reason about what it does, you can think about what it does. It roughly does what it says, and it's easy to draw these kinds of diagrams. So let's contrast this with a little bit of C code. If I do roughly the same thing in C, I have some different numbers here, but I have an A and a B, and I add those. This is the resulting code. At least to me, this is a bit more intimidating. So let's see what's going on here. First thing you notice is all these things starting with percent signs. Everything in x86 machine code that starts with a percent sign is a so-called register, the registers that are in your processor. And some of these are special. For instance, RBP points to what is known as the top of the stack. So when I take my first line, it says move the value 2A, so this is our 42, to minus 4 RBP. This says move this value, take this value, move it to 4 below the top of the stack. And then we have a similar instruction that does the same thing for 1-1, which is our 17. And it knows that it needs to go 8 below the top of the stack. So now we have the same stack as we had before in Java. But now something interesting happens. We move whatever is at 4 below the top of the stack to a register. An ECX is in this case an accumulator register. You can keep pushing values to it, and that is exactly what we're going to do. We're going to also take what is at location 8 below the top of the stack, which is our 17, move this to our ECX register, and we end up with an accumulated value there. So this is a bit different than what we saw before. Things of note here are that this code knows a whole lot about my machine. It knows that there are registers. It knows how many registers there are. It knows how big the chunks of my stack are. It knows that my stack grows downward. It has to calculate where in memory it has to put the values to end up at the right location on the stack. Again, contrasting this with the Java bytecode. On the left, we see the Java bytecode, which is what we call stack-based. It only says, I have a stack, push things onto it, and do operations on the things that are on the stack. The right side is what we call register-based. So that's one of the main differences we will see. There are a few other things I would like to point out. For instance, we don't only want to add numbers, we may want to call methods. Again, let's see what code this produces. We have our main method again, and we have our add method. First part of the main method is identical to what we had before. We load some stuff, put it in registers, and we end up with this situation, which is identical to what we had before. Instead of calling the add method, we now have the invoke static method. And this method says, call the method, in this case method number 2, the static method in this class, with however many parameters it needs from the top of the stack. So our main method started at the bottom of the stack, and now we take two parameters because my add method takes two parameters, and we call this the bottom of the stack of the add method. Now we jump into our method. We have two statements here which look rather familiar, an iload 1, iload 0, iload 1. We again load our values onto the stack. There we have our iAdd again. So we end up with our 46. And then we have an iReturn. An iReturn has nicely well-defined semantics. It basically says, throw away everything that you created on the stack, throw away all your mess, but only keep, and that's the I in iReturn, only keep the topmost integer. So let's do that. Let's throw away everything that's on the stack, keeping the topmost integer, and now we end up with the same situation we had before. We have our number added. This is something worth noting. This iReturn instruction is invoke static instruction. Those are things that you usually, on a normal machine, need to do by hand. Someone needs to make sure that things get pushed into the right registers and program counters get reset. This is not in Java bytecode. The Java machine does this, but your code doesn't need to tell it. Another one. Let's try creating objects. I create an object and I call the toString method on it. Code looks a bit like this. Again, we start out with an empty stack, and in this case, we only need one local variable. We have a new method, and the new, we'll get back to new later, says memory for a new instance of the class is allocated from the garbage collected heap. So apparently, there is a garbage collected heap. And the instance variables of the new object are initialized to their initial values. Okay, so we create an empty block of memory that represents our new object. But it does another thing. It also takes the reference to that object and pushes it onto the stack. So now we have something on the stack which points to a place in memory. Next instruction is a duplicate instruction, which basically says duplicate the top of the stack. We will need that later. Then we have an invoke special. Invoke special is in this case used for calling the constructor. So we call the object constructor, which basically means that we initialize the object. And while it's added, it removes the top of the stack. So that's why we did the duplicate before. We store and load the reference. You probably can guess what this does. And then we have our invoke virtual. This is a virtual method, our toString method on the object. And as you can see, the invoke virtual also takes a number. And this 3 says take the third virtual method, which is identified in this class file. And then we replace the top of the stack by the result of our toString. This invoke virtual is also something which sets apart the Java virtual machine from regular register-based machines. There's no need to go look up where in memory this method is. There's no need to calculate beforehand where in memory we have to jump to. The code literally says this. It says invoke virtual this method on this class. That's it. In fact, in this case, it only says invoke virtual this method because the JVM will know what kind of class it is. So far for calling methods. Another thing that sets Java apart from other languages is the polymorphism side, and I'll quickly skim over that. Let's say we have an interface and we translate this to bytecode. It does exactly the same thing, public abstract void m. Then we have an implementation of this interface with a method that does nothing. And it looks roughly how you would expect it. A class impl implements this interface, and we have a method m which only has a return statement in it. This other code creates an instance of my implementation, puts it into a member of the type interface, and calls the m method. For the most part, you should be able to read what is happening here now. We started with new, because we're going to create our class impl, we're going to duplicate it, and we're going to call the invoke special, that's our constructor part. We store it and we load it because we are going to do something to it. And then we have an invoke interface call. This invoke interface says, call the interface method M. This call does not know that there is actually an impl below it. It only knows that it wants to call an interface method on whatever is on the top of the stack. This is another thing that sets the Java Virtual Machine apart from your regular processor. Apparently, it knows about it knows about classes, it knows about interfaces, and you can use all of those constructs in your bytecode. This also means that if you create a new language which runs on top of the JVM, you don't need to build all of this stuff. You can use classes, you can use methods, you will get garbage collection, you will get optimization. A lot of functionality is in there. So summing up, for the JVM we have seen, Java gets translated to bytecode. It is a stack-based instruction set, which actually creates rather readable code. We have seen how memory is allocated, how methods are called, including special methods such as the constructor. And there's more in there which I didn't get to now. For instance, we have some of the concurrency primitives in there. Language keywords like instance of is actually in the JVM, because the JVM knows what a class is. So you don't need to build all of that in your own language. And a number of basic classes are in there. Things like strings, arrays, they are all in the JVM. I started this hour by inviting you to detox and just have a little bit of fun. But if you want to tell your boss what you actually learned today, I put up some snippets of a CV for you. So what are things you could put in your CV? You know that you rarely need to worry about memory allocation because that is all in the language. You know that the JVM provides pretty high-level primitives, up to interfaces, for writing your own languages, and you can now even read a little bit of bytecode, just like Tank in the Matrix. There was quite a lot of theory, and I've learned that the human attention span is about 20 minutes. We're over 20 minutes in now. So what I would like to do is get you moving a bit. What we're going to do, and I'll tell you when, is we're going to stand up, and I will show you on screen a number of JVM instructions. Some of them are real, and some of them I made up. And it's your job to determine, are these real, or did I make them up? If you get it right, you can remain standing. If you get it wrong, you can sit down. At the end, I even have a little prize for whoever manages to know the most about the Java Virtual Machine. So you can stand up now. I'm going to start with the first one, class. Raise your hand if you think that class is a real Java VM instruction. See quite a few hands. Too bad it isn't. If you've raised your hand, you can sit down now. Class is not an instruction. You may have seen it in the bytecode I showed you, but it's not much more than a language keyword. It is not an instruction. There is not an instruction that says class do something. Next one. Is if imgt a real instruction or is it not? Raise your hand. I think I see a little over half of you. Indeed, this is a real instruction. If you did not raise your hand, you can sit down now. If imgt is basically a branch instruction. If something on the top of the stack is bigger than whatever is below it, then go to some other place in my program. Next one, JSR. Is or is not JSR a real virtual machine instruction? I see just a few hands raised. You raise your hand if you think it is a real instruction. I see one hand go up very enthusiastically. It is. Ooh. Well, that weeds it out nicely, doesn't it? JSR is a jump to a subroutine within a method. And I guess that most of you may have been confused by the Java specification request. The Java community process uses specification requests, and those are nicely numbered. Those are called JSR too, but JSR is a real instruction. Next one, Kitson. Is Kitson a real instruction, or is it not? I see some men over there stoically, their arms crossed. Very good. Kitson is not a real instruction. Next one, GoTo. Is GoTo a real instruction? We have two more after this. Is GoTo a real instruction? It is. I think we have just two participants left now. It says go to a given address within a method. It does not allow you to jump willy-nilly over the memory. But you can only go to a fixed location within your own method. Next one, itclip. Is or is not, you know the routine by now, a real instruction or is it not? I've used two participants left. What is itclip? Last one, table switch. Final one, is table switch a real instruction or is it not? Too bad, it is. But both of you, please remain standing. Otherwise, I don't have anyone to give my prize to. Table switch is what you use to build, for instance, the case statement. You jump to an indexed location based on a value. So it's pretty close to the if compare greater, the one at the top middle. But this one is used for case statements. So we have two participants left. I've prepared a quick shootout question for this. If I am to do this, this code downloads the current version of the Hotspot VM from OpenJDK, counts all the lines of C and C++ code. So we don't need to bicker about what exactly constitutes C++ code. This is the way I count them. How many lines of code are there in the JVM? Gentleman in front, what do you think? You don't know, just make up a number. 10,000. Gentleman behind? It's more. How much more? 11,000? I hear 10,000 and 11,000. It's big, isn't it? There we have it. 1.3 million. 1.3 million lines of code. So all the way in the back, you win our, indeed, give a hand of applause, our I Know All About the JVM, and all I got was this awesome t-shirt. If you can catch, then I maybe can throw. Ah, too bad. Where is the pride? So now we're all reinvigorated. We can dive into the last half hour. Starting with something I pointed to beforehand, which is this intriguing statement. And it says, and the letters are small for me, memory for a new instance of that class is allocated from the garbage collected heap. So apparently we don't only have a heap, but it's also garbage collected. Of course, you know that Java does its own memory management. You don't need to do that for the JVM. But how does it work? The Hotspot VM, which we just learned has more than 11,000 lines of code, has a pluggable infrastructure for garbage collection. And what I'm going to show you is a sketch of roughly how most of the garbage collectors work. There are some intriguing details which are worth a talk in its own. But for now, let's say that our heap is a contiguous space of memory. And I start allocating objects on this heap, one after the other, until it fills up. And then at some moment in time, we want to allocate more memory. We have what we call a GC, an allocation failure, and we need to start cleaning up memory. But how do we know what is in use and what isn't? For this, we use a process called walking the heap. And we start at garbage collect routes. Garbage collect routes are local variables, so things that are on the stack. Active thread objects, so this thing could be a thread object which may be reactivated sometime later. We may have static variables. Static variables are things that are not on the stack because they're in a class. And we have JNI objects. I can skip those for now, because for JNI you need to do most of the memory management yourself anyway. We have marked a few as garbage collect routes. Now what we start doing is we start following all the references until we have found everything that is currently still in use. And now we also know that some things are not in use and they can be removed. This process is known as mark and sweep. The first phase is marking everything that is still in use. Second phase is sweeping up everything that you don't use anymore. And you know you don't use them because you have marked the things you were still using. So now I have some memory, great. But if I want to allocate this block of memory, it probably won't fit. I have enough memory, that is not the issue. But I just cannot find a block of memory which is big enough to accommodate it. So therefore we move over some of the objects so we can now fit in the new object. This is known as compaction. So we have seen mark and sweep to clean up memory, and we have seen compaction so we can get back at a contiguous block of memory. That's all well and good, but how does that work for huge heaps? Heaps in the gigabytes are not all that special anymore. Memory up to a few terabytes of Java heap space is actually being used in practice. It could then take a long time to find out for all of these objects, are they still in use? We can use a nice statistics for this. And this is actually a probably really tragic thing for our objects, but most of them die really young. Most objects don't survive even a single garbage collect cycle. It kind of depends on your language, but if you're using plain Java, this might be 98-99%. A lot of memory is only used, a lot of objects are only used during one garbage collect cycle. What we do then is we use this trick to our advantage. So if we have some block of memory, we may have a few objects in there which we still use. Instead of cleaning up all the rest and compacting it, we create a new block of memory, move in all of the objects that we still use from what is known as Eden space. Eden space is where all the new allocations happen. And we have moved them to what is known as the survivor space. We can now just throw away everything that was in the Eden space because we have a copy of everything we still use in the survivor space. And we can start allocating objects in the Eden space again until it fills up. Most garbage collectors have a number of these spaces. We then have a tenured space. Some of them have a permanent space. And this is known as generational garbage collection. As for the garbage collectors that are available, with Java 1.0 we had a serial garbage collector, which basically does the marking, then does the sweeping, and then gives control back to the program. This worked fine for a while. It is also known as a stop the world garbage collector, because when an allocation failure happens, it stops your program, starts doing its work, and then gives control back. Then we have a few versions where this worked fine, and in Java 1.2 we got a parallel garbage collector. And parallel in this case means that it can use multiple threads. It is still a stop the world garbage collector, but it can do the marking and the sweeping using multiple threads, so it's using your processor more effectively. Then in Java 1.4, we got a concurrent mark sweep collector. Concurrent mark sweep means that it can do a lot of its work while your program is still running. So it doesn't need to stop the world. This is known as mostly concurrent. It doesn't need to stop the world, but it can do most of its work while your program is running. And only when, for instance, pointers need to be moved around, we stop your program. Then in Java 7, we got a G1 garbage collector. And starting Java 9, G1 is the default garbage collector. G1 is optimized for big heaps and for more predictable pause times. It tries to keep the garbage collect pauses below a given number of milliseconds. Those are not the only garbage collectors. For instance, we have the ZGC garbage collector, which is an alternative collector by Oracle. Which is intended for, again, huge heaps, multiple terabytes. And it knows really well how to use stuff around in memory. So it can do compaction, it can move stuff that will stay together for a long time to the same region. And Red Hat has introduced a Shenandoah collector, which is a so-called regional garbage collector. It doesn't have just three generations, it has a bunch of regions, and it allocates objects in these regions based on heuristics it gathered from the running program. You can also inspect what the garbage collector does. When running a program, and I have a program here that just allocates an object which has three ints in it and does that a whole lot of times. When running a program, you can ask it to print GC details. This is something that works on the Hotspot VM, doesn't work on all VMs. And I've purposely given it a really small amount of memory here, just 16 megs. Let's see what happens. Pretty quickly, this is not real time, of course, pretty quickly we run into what says, it says here, an allocation failure. This is a line that's a lot longer, there's a lot of information in here. It says, I started garbage collecting because there is an allocation failure. Someone wanted to use memory, but I don't have any memory available. It tells me that the young generation, the Eden space, moved from a little over 4 megabytes to about 500K. The number in parentheses is what is known as the committed space for that memory, for that type of memory. As soon as we need more than that, we start requesting more memory from the OS. We also get an overview of the totals. So we moved from 496 to 456K. So that's more than the 448 that is left in the young generation. So some things have been bumped up a generation, apparently. And our total committed memory is this. It is almost 60 megabytes. We also have some timing information here. The first block of timing you saw is the absolute time that is spent using in garbage collecting. It's not that long. Both the user, system, and real values here are zero. User is user kernel space, which is ring three time. All the sys time is time waiting for the OS. So when we're requesting new memory, we have to wait for the operating system. And the real time is the absolute time that your system was frozen, which may be shorter than the user time, because the user time could have run on multiple threads. If we run this application further, we see that we have another garbage collect failure and another allocation failure, and then the system stops garbage collecting. That's interesting. We'll get back to that. Let's first sum up garbage collection. We have seen that most garbage collectors use mark and sweep or some variation of it. Mark everything that is still in use by following the path from a number of garbage collect routes. Then we have compaction. We try to move memory closer together, so we have contiguous spaces. And we use a generational mechanism because we know that most objects die young. And we have seen that there are stop-the-world collectors versus concurrent connectors. So what have you learned? What have you learned? You have learned that a garbage collector usually doesn't mess up your application until it does. And as soon as you start seeing weird behavior, it may be time to inspect what the garbage collector is actually doing. I've shown you the statement for that. And a big takeaway for this is don't worry about garbage collection until you need to, until you see runtime problems that are caused by garbage collection. Don't try optimizing your code. The VM can usually do it a lot better for you. Moving on to optimization. We have seen that the Java bytecode is just a bunch of bytes and is the value on top here. And this may be translated to a lot of instruction code. The red part is probably housekeeping, and the green part is the thing you actually want to have happen. And some instructions may be just housekeeping for the JVM. This is what is known as level zero execution. This is interpreted. We have an interpreter that takes one instruction, takes the parameters for the instruction, and starts executing it. At some point, the VM may recognize that this block of code, I've seen this before. In fact, I may have seen this 1,000 times before. This may be a hotspot. This, by the way, is where the name hotspot VM comes from. What it now does is it creates a specific block of machine code for the processor, which has less housekeeping and more actual useful code. And whenever it sees this block of bytecode, it will execute this block of machine code. This is known as compiled operation. And this mechanism is known as tiered compilation. We start out interpreting, and then we start compiling. Compiling isn't the end of it. We also have something known as optimization. And it's quite tricky to get optimized code out of the JVM. So I'll give you an analog in C code. This code basically prints the numbers 0, 1, 2 using a loop. And if I just compile this and dump the code the way we did before, it looks a little bit like this. We have a few things we recognize here. We have a compare and a jump. This is probably the start of the for loop jumping to the end, because the address is an address at the bottom of the loop. Just before that, we have a jump back to the top of the loop, which is this address. This is how loops are implemented in machine code. We have another interesting thing here, and this is this call queue statement. And what I can tell you is that this call queue is a printf statement. So we have a pretty accurate representation of what we wrote in C code, in machine code. We have a loop, we have our prints. Now, if I do this same thing with -03, which in this case is an optimization level for the GCC compiler, and with code that looks a bit different, my compares are gone, my jumps are gone, but I did get something else. I got not one, not two, but three call queue statements. What happens here is that the compiler understood that jumping around is relatively expensive. It is a lot more efficient to just what we call unroll the loop. Instead of creating a loop, we create the effect of the loop. This mechanism is known as loop unrolling. It's available for GCC, and the Java Virtual Machine uses this whenever it's necessary. And there are a few levels of aggressiveness of optimization. These are levels 2 to 4. So that's one part of optimization, just making sure that our code is more efficient than it was before. There's another thing. We've seen roughly this code before. What I've done now is I've inserted some timing statements, so we can actually see how long the creation of 100,000 of these objects take. And we now see that there is only one garbage collect cycle in here. We saw two before. That's not all that relevant. What we see is that the allocation time goes down dramatically. It goes down by two orders of magnitude. What's going on here is the following. If I am to naively create and process this code, I would do something like this. I have a heap. On this heap, I create a thing. And I create a reference to that thing on my stack. Then we get to the end of the for loop, so we get to line number 9. We remove the thing, the reference to the thing from the stack, and my thing becomes garbage immediately. And then we have the next iteration of the loop, and we keep creating garbage in memory. Every time at the end of the loop, my thing T goes out of scope, so the underlying object can be garbage collected. The JVM notices this and knows that it is not efficient to do this. So what it does instead is it takes the object, it knows that this object will never escape this loop, and just allocates the fields on the stack. So at the end of the loop, we just clean up the stack, and we don't have to clean up any more memory. We can do this again and again and again. This is the 100 order of magnitude, the 2 order of magnitude speedup. This mechanism is known as escape analysis. So I've shown you a few different ways that the virtual machine optimizes. We have seen that we start out interpreted. Then we have tiered compilation. We start out interpreting, then we start compiling, and then we start optimizing with different levels of aggressiveness. And of course, aggressive optimization takes time. It takes time up front, so you can buy that back later. This is why Java processors tend to speed up for a while they're running, while the VM is gathering statistics about your code is how your code is actually being used. It doesn't need to guess like a compiler does. It can just measure. We have seen types of machine code optimization. So we have our code, and we can make it faster, for instance, by doing loop unrolling. There are a number of other methods to do this. We have seen dynamic optimization, in this case, escape analysis. The VM doesn't just inspect the code. It actually checks when this piece of code is running, does a pointer, do this block of memory actually move to some other scope in the program? And there are a number of other things. We have out-of-order execution. Sometimes it's beneficial to do certain things in another order than the programmer specified. We have branch prediction. You always took the then branch here and not the else branch. So let's just start executing that, assuming that you actually will do that this time. We can eliminate that code. There are a number of ways that the VM is actually a lot smarter than you can probably be. So on your resume, you could put that you know that the JVM can probably do a better job optimizing than you can. Make sure your code is readable and maintainable. Optimization will get handled by the JVM. Another thing that's interesting is that longer running processes tend to speed up because the Hotspot VM now has the time to gather statistics. Time for a little detour. I will take a detour to the Delphic VM, or actually, it's known as the Android runtime nowadays. For the interest of this discussion, these are interchangeable. And I take a look at the Android VM because it is a VM which runs Java-ish code on a platform with totally different constraints. For instance, a server process will keep running for days on end. When you switch from Instagram to Diaspora, or whatever it is you're using nowadays, you don't want to wait for 3 seconds for the optimization to happen. You want this code running immediately. You're not running this on big server hardware. You're running this on a phone, which may have less memory, which may have a slower processor. So there are different constraints. And we'll look at the Delphic VM to see how these constraints work out in what the VM is actually doing. We've seen before that Java code gets compiled into a class file. And when I have an older file, it also gets compiled into a class file. First difference is that DX, the Delphic execution environment, takes these classes together into one block. This for one reason has to do with the optimization. Optimization happens over the entire piece of code, not just every class in isolation. Let's see what this actually does. I have code that looks identical to what we've shown before. Still, I'm still adding 2 numbers, and I put these into a result. The Android toolkit comes, of course, with a compiler, so we can take a look at what is actually in this file. And we immediately see that this is something different. For instance, it starts with DEX, claiming that this is a DEX file. It's a totally different format. I'm not going to follow all the calls. We have DEXDump, which is the equivalent of the Java P program we saw earlier. And when I print this class, it looks a bit like this. You see that there's a lot more information in here, but that just has to do with the way that DEXDump processes and shows things. But there is something interesting in here. When you take a look at our method, you can see it almost at you can see it in the middle of the screen. We have a method that is our main method. It takes an array of string. That all looks pretty. Pretty benign. Then we have our main method, and we have our method, and it says return. It doesn't do anything. We only have a return statement in here. Of course, that makes sense, because this code doesn't do anything. It doesn't have any side effects. The DEX, the DX command will verify this code and see this code will never be run, so we can just remove it. Okay, let's make things a little bit more interesting then. Let's force the creation of these objects by actually creating a side effect. I have a print line on my line 6 now. What do we have then? I have a lot of code, but I still don't see my 42 and my 4. I do, however, see a 46. Which makes sense. There is no code path which makes it that this code ends up with anything else than 46 in the result. Another type of static optimization. What we also see is that in my code I use string concatenation, but it actually is using a string builder. This is more efficient in terms of memory, but you don't need to worry about that. So now let's make things really unoptimizable and just have some random value in here. Then we get to something that looks closer to what we would expect. We have a V0 which holds our 42. This is probably the A is 42 statement. We have a double to int, which is this cast down here, which has a V1 and a V2. And we have an add int to adder v0 v1. That's probably the addition. Specification says that the add statement takes two things. It takes a destination and first source register. So this knows there are actually registers. And it takes a second source register. So what it does is it takes v0 and it takes v1. Takes what is in V1, adds it into V0, and keeps the result in V0. This, again, is a register-based machine. We saw that the Java virtual machine is stack-based. The actual processor in your phone is register-based. We can see in the specification statement here that it assumes that there are 4 bits available, so that there are 16 addresses, 16 registers available. For a desktop processor, that's usually not true. For a phone processor, which are usually ARM processors, this may be true. This code knows a lot about the environment it's running on. Also, because a lot of the optimization happens beforehand, we have faster startup times. So within ART, we have seen that the different constraints that this thing has means that we put all of our code into a single archive. It means that we have some compile time optimizations. We remove dead code. We have code level optimization. I haven't shown it to you here, but it will also do loop unrolling when beneficial. And it is a register-based system. So again, totally different constraints end us up with a totally different implementation. What could you put on your CV? You know that Delphic is a totally different thing, even though it speaks Java. And you can now explain, just to impress people at parties, why these different trade-offs were made and why your phone, which you just paid €1,100 for, is so snappy. It has to do not with the phone, it has to do with this ahead of time optimization. And By the way, more optimization actually happens when the code is being downloaded to your phone. Some register allocations, for instance, are phone-specific, and those are calculated while you install the program on your phone instead of doing this during the operation of the program. So summing up, we have seen the JVM. It runs bytecode, which you can create from Java code. It has a stack-based instruction set, which actually gives you pretty readable code. We have seen how memory allocation works. We have seen how methods are called. We have seen that virtual methods are a thing, that interface methods are a thing. And I've pointed to a number of other things that are in the JVM, making it a very rich environment. We've talked about garbage collection, first marking, then sweeping, then compacting, and possibly using a generational mechanism. And we have seen the difference between stop the world collectors, which stop your program, do their work, and then give control back, versus mostly concurrent collectors, which can do most of their work in the background. And that's a trade-off. When a collector does most of its work in the background, the total time spent collecting will go up, because it needs locking, it needs all kinds of synchronization. But the time that it actually messes with the running time of your program will be slower. Will be less. We've seen all kinds of cool things with optimization. We've seen this tiered compilation mechanism with different levels of aggressiveness of optimization. We have seen the example of loop unrolling, which is an example of code level optimization, and we have seen dynamic optimization in the shape of escape analysis. And we've taken a look at the Delvik VM, which is Java-ish, but works differently. Uses a single archive, uses more and more aggressive optimization at compile time, and is register-based because the processor in your phone is register-based. That is it for me. If you want to play around with the code, go ahead. All the Java code should run on your own machine. You will need the Android toolkit if you want to run the Android code. The machine code for now only supports Mac. I haven't gotten around to actually running this on Linux. So if you're up for it and wish to submit a pull request, be my guest. Thank you.